Okay. Meanwhile, GCPL continues to be in focus on back of their Q1 numbers, which were largely in line. We caught up with the management. Here's an excerpt.
Yes, I do think that they obviously, as we saved cost in certain areas like travel or advertising came down, I think there were extra costs in the supply chain, which will sort of get smoothened off as the year sort of progresses. I think it's also a bit of a sort of category and portfolio mix. So some of the higher, more discretionary, higher gross margin products sequentially were better over the quarter, but in April was sort of weak. So I do think we'll see a positive movement on that going forward.
Sure. If you really had to highlight, Isaba, category-wise, and we'll get into details of each category in just a bit, where would you say the maximum pressure was felt?
So, like I sort of mentioned, 85% of our portfolio is actually household insecticides, hygiene, and value for money products. So actually, in household insecticides, we grew at 27%. In hygiene, we grew at 15%. And value for money did see a decline of 13%, but sequentially was much better month over month. I think 15% of our portfolio, which we call others, which broadly is our air care business and some, and this is globally, I think we definitely felt pressure there. But I think we will see some amount of demand coming back. We are seeing month over month, and July has been quite a strong month for us. And we're also doing things in these categories that are more discretionary to pivot. So say in air care, we've sort of combined the benefits of disinfectant with air freshener. So you will see us do things to sort of go where the consumer demand is.
Sure. What's compensated at a macro level, Isaba, for the margin compression has been the savings that you guys have made in advertising spends. I don't know when things would get back to normal. Perhaps you would have a better handle on that. But like we were chatting just before the show began, do you think COVID has made you realize that there are better ways of advertising, perhaps? And do you see a sustained saving in your ad spends going forward?
Yeah, I think actually we didn't advertise also because of the supply constraints we faced, correct? This was also a quarter of sort of supply constraints. But we have our new product portfolio. We're seeing this huge demand for household insecticides and hygiene. So our role is we are going against water in a situation like this, but execution is key. So expanding distribution and creating, informing consumers, say in Protect, here are the new products that we have. We will continue to do that. Yes, but there have been lots of new learnings and in a year like this, where to invest and where not to, we'll need sort of careful calibration. But I do think you will see investments in advertising definitely increase over what happened in quarter one.
Sure. Like you as well reiterated that it's the HI segment, which more so post-COVID is going to be of utmost significance. Not in the near term, but maybe another 2-3 years down the line. What sort of contribution do you see coming in from the HI segment?
Household insecticides is 30% of our global portfolio. So I think we're looking to grow across our categories, especially sort of grow out hygiene. So I would think that household, because of the overall growth of the sort of company, I'm not sure that the salience would change that much over 2 or 3 years. Obviously, if this health and this COVID's not going anywhere anytime soon. So I would say maybe the household insecticides along with hygiene as a percentage of our global portfolio will probably increase. But I don't know how much of that will be household insecticides versus the other hygiene products.
sure. But as I understand, you know, you've launched about 45 products in the hygiene segment across geographies and saw very strong growth of about almost 15% in the category. Any new innovations, you know, because COVID has taught us to do things differently and in new ways, and has also in that sense created a vast new opportunity for perhaps new product innovations that you would understand better. Besides these 45 products, what else is in the pipeline when it comes to the hygiene category specific, because, you know, that's the direct interlinkage with COVID.
Yeah, so I think, you know, one of GCPL's strength is this sort of innovation, value for money, low-cost manufacturing. So I think we're quite excited to bring that full force to the hygiene category. You know, we already have products like Magic, which is a powder-to-liquid hand wash, which is probably the world's most affordable and most sustainable hand wash. So we see, you know, products like that really having very strong lift off, and we will look to do more things like that, which are sort of disruptive and unique to us. You know, I think if you look at something like the hand sanitizer market, I think there have been 600 brands launched. So I don't think, you know, we are trying to play I think differentiation is very important to us, uniqueness, value for money, creating access to consumers, correct? Only about 17% of Indians have running water. So how do you actually create hygiene when you're in a situation that doesn't support it? So I think that's where GCPL has always been quite strong. So you will see quite a bit of that coming from us.
Sure. You know, I would have believed that vanity doesn't die down that easily, but the lockdown has taught us new things, and I understand that women are not opting for hair colors. They're fine with the grays. But I'm guessing, you know, now with the unlocking happening, hair colors as a segment, Misawa, would pick up gradually. Tell me a little bit more about when you actually see a full-blown recovery coming in. And have online sales already seen an uptick?
So we are seeing, you know, so I'm laughing a little bit because in our consumer research, actually women are saying that, no, you know, we want to look good and we don't want to sit around the house looking bad. Well, I think men are a little bit more lazy. So, you know, I wanted to share that from a consumer perspective. But what we are seeing, is that especially in the value for money segments, which, in hair color or braids in Africa, which is, you know, 50% actually of our Africa business, we are sort of seeing quite strong sequential growth. Correct. April was a washout, but then every month is sort of increasing. So I think the beauty category we play in is not very high end. It's not that I'm going to a party, correct? It's also women sort of use these products on a day to day basis. So I feel confident. I feel quite confident of that. And one of the happiest things that's made me really happy at this time is I've sent our 30 rupee hair color to lots of my friends who are like, why have we been wasting all this time with very expensive product? So, you know, GCPL on quality.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, why invest in those exorbitant ones which were not even available during lockdown, as I understand. But you know, as per your margins trajectory, Nisaba, where do you actually see your margins headed in the next few quarters? And I'm not talking about the immediate next quarter, but the visibility that you have for the next 1 year or 2 year perhaps. And which segment do you see a maximum contribution coming in from?
I see us having quite resilient growth. I think, you know, quarter one has, you know, been pretty resilient, and I see us sort of double downing on our execution and, you know, really sort of delivering this year. I think this this health and hygiene, the, you know, the household insecticides and hygiene, I see very strong demand, you know, continuing, not just in India, but in sort of other geographies, also. And I actually would also sort of bet on this, you know, what we call value for money, which is the hair colors, you know, in India or in our Latin American business, or braids, which is a big portion of our Africa business. I think they're going to be sort of really resilient, because if consumers do have, you know, less money in their pockets, they will want, you know, the highest quality but affordable products, which has always been our strength. So, you know, I feel that we will be sort of resilient around 85% of our portfolio. For the other 15%, you know, say something like air care, one of the actually big impacts was in the car segment. Cause, I mean, lockdown, no one's driving. So we'll see. I think some of these things will sequentially pick up.
Yeah, but you know, there could be a lot of pent-up demand, as was the case with car batteries. Once everyone does begin to use their cars and getting them clean, I think those car fresheners would definitely see a lot of pent-up demand for you.
Yeah, and like,
the problem seems to be the Africa business, and a lot of analysts that I spoke with. No, go ahead, complete your point.
No, please, you go ahead. I didn't,
No, finish your point, please.
I was just going to make my, for the car also, we have a lot of products which are air freshening and sanitization, which we feel, you know, will be important. So, you were asking about Africa.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I was just saying that, you know, a lot of analysts that I was speaking with about your earnings and the company visibility are saying that, you know, Africa business needs a quick solution. We understand that a few steps have been put in process, but help your shareholders and analysts and investors understand what exactly is going on with the Africa business and what's the recovery plan that you've put in place.
Sure. So I think, you know, for our Africa business, if I look at what happened in sort of quarter one, April was like a complete washout. So, I mean, just the business sort of dropped. And then we sort of started seeing recovery, first maybe mid-May. And, you know, June was much stronger. July has actually been a strong month in that business. So, you know, in definitely positive, strong positive growth. So I think, you know, April was definitely, because of the lockdowns, there were very strict lockdowns in these countries and stuff. But I think even in Africa, you know, our execution has sort of been really strong. So I've had strong braid growth, but that's also because my factories opened the first, we were out of the door. And, you know, we are doing... We're not doing rocket science here, correct? It's about increasing distribution, giving consumers the products they want, going where the demand is. And I think things like hygiene and household insecticides have, you know, huge opportunities on the African continent. So we've actually had a very successful, you know, it's early days now in household insecticides in Africa. You know, and I have told analysts, look, I can't convince you on an interview. You'll have to watch the performance. And we're very, very committed sort of to putting the business on the right track.
Watch the space. It should be your tagline, Nisaba, for them.
Yeah, I'm putting quite a bit of pressure on myself with that in my last interview.
Okay. No, but you know, you're not new to the functionings of the company, clearly. This has been family business and you've been raised in the environment. What sort of vision have you set for GCPL for, say, the next 3 years? I know COVID has just about thrown everything off the ball, but in the next 3 years, where is it that you want to take the company?
So, you know, and... you know, I have shared the bad news that, you know, the last sort of 18 months to couple of years have not been good for us. But, you know, over the last decade, GCPL's had a phenomenal run. And, you know, we actually 10x our size, you know, over the last sort of decade, starting in about 2000, you know, when we started our journey in 2007. So, you know, I really want us to get back to strong double-digit growth organically. So I really think the strength of the company is this innovation, value for money, low-cost manufacturing. So just do what we do well, roll up leaves, and just get back to growth. So I think that's my sort of single-minded focus over the next couple of years. And I think in consumer, in, you know, our sort of businesses, if you get growth, then the profitability does follow because you have scale leverage. So that's what I want to focus on. And I really think this is, you know, our time, because consumers, you know, to serve our consumers well, because they are, you know, they want to stay healthy, they want to, you know, protect themselves from malaria and dengue, they want to be able to have affordable products to wash their hands and keep their homes clean, and that is our, you know, that is where we are sort of really good. And I think even in the beauty segment, whether it's in our extensions business in Africa, you know, hair color across the globe, we have these amazing high quality affordable products. So we just, I think we need to do more of what we do and just do it really well.
All right, that was about the lengthy conversation between Aisha Faridi and Nisarga Godrej at Godrej Consumer, but nonetheless very important given that their performance is right now in focus. But switching gears, Amazon Prime Day is back with some amazing offerings exclusively for the Prime members. You too can get great